Okay, let us go ahead and get ourselves started with session 16. Today we want to just kind of pull together lots of different little threads about HVAC systems and try to just really get you guys set up in terms of modeling systems the way you're going to need them for your own projects. So I want to talk some more about less ducted systems, but sort of look at some other examples like radiant systems or split systems or different systems that aren't so much just pushing a lot of air, but actually use a little bit of water to go through and kind of do the heating and cooling. Okay, think about how we analyze all these things in terms of the design loads that then start to dictate just how much both either air we're going to push around or for ventilation or for heating and cooling. Okay, and then even start drifting towards plumbing systems because we're right on the cusp of that in terms of thinking about how that layers into your buildings too. As we get going though, let's just talk a little about sort of your buildings in terms of your current understanding of, you know, what are you thinking about in terms of sort of a heating and cooling strategy at this point? And again, there's no right or wrong answers. It's all just sort of where your thinking is as of today. So has anyone started like putting any ductwork in or sort of doing modeling of an HVAC system? Not yet? No worries, that's okay. I think a lot of us are sort of right there. Most people are still finishing up structural and building envelope and things like that. Okay, if you are, that's good in terms of, you know, we need to ultimately sort of get the appropriate thermal values understood so that as we start to calculate the loads, we know really what the losses are gonna be. I think that's wrapping up. Maybe not. Let's swing the door. Comes out of the wall. Systems, even better if you haven't done a whole lot of modeling yet. As you're thinking about your buildings, like, you know, just let's kind of think of an overall strategy about how you might approach them. Like, Gustavo, as you think about your building, an existing building, so what do you sort of think about in terms of how you might heat and cool this space? Okay, so there'll be an air handling unit or two. You have sort of almost two buildings that are interconnected, so there might be two. Okay, in terms of thinking about one or two, it's kind of the whole issue of depending on how you break the air that's coming, if we sort of put in some sort of a VAV box or something, we can take the air and sort of split it and control the temperature that's being delivered to the two different zones independently. But it may just make sense from a kind of ducting standpoint, rather than trying to run all the ducts from a single location, to have one air handler maybe on the roof of the bigger building and a second air handler on the roof of the second building. Or even it could be downstairs in the kind of utility space in the back. It could be a lot of different places. Okay, so it could make sense to split that. Again, putting it all together, there's often some efficiency to having it together, but having multiple systems often works well if you have different uses, things where one building, like the kind of social hall, is going to be used discreetly at a very separate set of times. You might want to not heat and cool it at times that it's not being used, where the main offices would need to be heated and cooled all the time. Yeah, you can sort of think about that. Okay, but ducting kind of makes sense for doing something like that.
Are we doing the duct layout for the whole building or a portion of it like we did with structure?
I think, again, you can sort of focus on like one of the buildings. I think especially for some of the bigger buildings. Like, yeah, if you have a complex of buildings, or you have a very big building. In fact, even Brittany, I think you have you as having almost a complex of buildings. Think about doing it for one of the buildings, not necessarily for all of them, unless you're feeling really ambitious. Even Christine, I think for you, you have like, you know, several buildings that sort of work their way around with uppers and lowers, and think about doing it for, you know, a portion of the building as opposed to necessarily doing it for all the spaces. So it could be the big L-shaped offices, it could be the more retail Starbucks-y spaces with a gym, mm-hmm. it might be upstairs. If you do have kind of the relationship between the upper and the lower in a building, it might be kind of cool just to think about how, you know, it works between the two different floors to have some ducts that actually run up between the different levels.
So rather than doing the entire system, like roughly do the entire system and then focus on one.
Yeah, exactly. Even at a high level, if you just wanted to sort of roughly focus, but don't even worry about hooking it all together, if you just ran sort of the main duct locations, you know, just run the main branch kind of coming down the line, but don't really articulate it and detail it, that's okay. Because, yeah, the big thing is really just trying to get a sense of really where your ducts are going to be relative to your structure. You know, so that if you, you know, run a lot of ducts a long distance, the ducts are getting bigger, so you have to allow some space for them. If you have a more decentralized strategy, they might be a little easier to accommodate kind of in the spaces. But try to think about just sort of a sensible breaking point. Like for Henry, as you think about your building, how do you think about it from a heating and cooling standpoint?
I was going to decide after this lecture, I was going to learn more about rating systems, but
very good.
Envisioning a combination.
Yeah.
I think predominantly using the rating floor, and then if like some rooms like really heavily occupied, maybe some air would kick in.
Yeah. So that strategy is a good strategy that makes an awful lot of sense in newer buildings, especially if you kind of have, well, especially if you have sort of, I want to say if it's very favorable, like, you know, here in the Bay Area, we have very favorable temperatures and stuff like that. You can really provide almost all the heating and cooling necessary just through a radiant system, which will tend to be more efficient just because heat and cool transmit a little more efficiently through water than air. There's less energy loss kind of as you're transmitting them around. The big difference, really, in a lot of cases is in an older building, if you don't really have the ability to sort of pour a new concrete topping layer on top of the existing floor, it's, you know, a little bit of work to retrofit in a radiant system. You do it, we even do it in residential applications. They'll run the pipes and they'll run like a thin layer of concrete on top, which is really just to sort of distribute the heat evenly, or they'll even run the radiant pipes under the floor joists. Okay, which is not as efficient because then they're just really heating air. It's better if you heat up something that has a high thermal mass. Okay, but you know, either of those systems can be used almost anywhere. In a lot of buildings, most of the older building stock in the U.S., it's predominantly an air-based system because radiant systems didn't, used to be, well, I take that back. In the ones that were built in the last 30 or 40 years. If you go way on back, it's almost always radiator systems, okay, where if you've been in a lot of older buildings, especially on the East Coast, there's radiators along the side wall, and there's some sort of either steam coming to them, because there's a central steam plant that's generating heat, and they sort of pass steam around. Or in a lot of homes, it could be hot water. There's radiants. You know, we'll take a look at some of those different systems. Okay, so just thinking about your overall strategy, and again, don't necessarily do it exhaustively. I'd rather you sort of look at a specific area and articulate that in a lot of detail and really pay attention to that, as opposed to kind of just trying to do everything. Okay, so really see if you can kind of do it at some level of detail. Okay, in terms of the modeling, we've been looking at all these different sort of air-based systems. Let me go ahead and do this. We're going to go ahead and let me talk about radiant systems too and how you actually model them. Then we'll talk about the whole issue of really how we calculate the heating and cooling loads, which at a high level really sizes the whole system. So at some point we need either a boiler of some type or a chiller of some type, okay, or some sort of package unit up on the roof, something that's going to go through and either generate or take away heat. You know, it could be a heat pump of some type. But there's going to be some loads that are really dependent upon like what we put in the building. But let's go ahead and just start out with some radiant systems, because maybe that might be a little bit easier. If you can go ahead and open up, let's go over to Revit, and we'll take a look at radiant systems in a couple different ways. We'll look at radiators, okay, which are more discrete, and we'll look at like a whole radiant floor, which is a more integrated approach to that. So I'm gonna go over. Yes, it's there. What are you looking down? They're so low there. Make that happen again. Make sure I'm still recording. I didn't lose that. Excellent. Okay, so here we are over in Revit, and in terms of looking at some of these, you'll find some examples. I think I put them in the session 15 folder. Let me go and check back over there. And let's go to the heating and cooling equipment kind of folder. And oh, even in here, let's go to 9A heaters and radiators. Oh, let's check it out. Are they in the, let's see if they're in 15 or 14 or where I've actually put them.
It should be in 15, but since last time you tried to upload it, I don't think it's.
Okay, let's just take a look. Let's see what we got going on here. Hang on. There's my window, there's my window, there's my files. Ah, okay, look at that. Let me go through and publish that. Okay, they should be out there for you now. So go ahead and download those. I'll just open this up and take a look at it in 3D, and we'll think about some of the variations we have on things. Okay, so at the top of this diagram, it's the same little kind of simple building we've been looking at. At the top there, there's really just some sort of air handling unit up on the roof. You can see that in each of the different classrooms right now, there's currently set up another type of system. We have a little VAV unit. That's the part that's actually happening right here. Okay, and then we have just basically some ductwork, which is going back and feeding kind of the supply air in. Okay, so if we wanted to go through and think about using a radiator of some type or some sort of like discrete space heater, we could do that. There are different radiator units. You can sort of see a couple of them sort of lined up on the wall over there. But let me see if I can kind of rotate this around. And we'll take a look at them from a slightly better perspective. You'll see here I have a couple of different things that are interesting. This guy over here is some sort of unit heater. Let's just kind of take a look at it. This little unit heater is actually an electric one right now. You may be familiar with these if you have an older home and you have like one of these in the bathroom, or they could be almost anywhere. The little electric heater, it basically uses a lot of power and just sort of either radiates some heat out or blows some heat out. But it was kind of a very common way of just sort of supplementing things. It's not exactly the most efficient way of doing it, but the advantage about something like this is there's not even any ductwork. There really just is like some sort of like electrical load, and based on that electrical load, we're gonna pull in and basically shoot out some heat. Okay, so, you know, kind of easy to go through and put together. What's happening over here? Here's another little unit heater. This is more of a baseboard heater. I'm just gonna take a look at it. Okay, just another way of doing it, as opposed to having a cabinet in the room, we could have just some little baseboard heater. This has some sort of heating elements in it, and it will go through and just radiate out some heat. We can edit this thing if you want to take a look at it. You'll see the only connection it has right now is the electrical connection. Okay, just right over here. So that's in one way to do it. There's a sort of history of providing electric heat, especially electric resistance heat. What happens is with electricity, if you sort of just run it through some very resistant material, it'll go through and put out heat. The resistant material will just sort of glow. and just where the loss of energy comes out to you as a source of heat. We used electric heating, even in the US we used it kind of back in the 60s. There was a time when we thought electricity was going to be very, very plentiful and very, very cheap because we're going to have nuclear power plants in every town that would go through and generate all this energy. So there was the whole idea of an all-electric home, and it was kind of one of the ideals back in the 1960s and 70s. Okay, the idea of having something all totally electric, if you had infinite electricity to work with, why not? It's clean. You don't burn it like gas. You don't burn it like oil, which people were comparing to. You just sort of have electricity. And since nuclear energy is a clean fuel, you ignore the long-term waste. It sounded like a really good idea. Yeah. We ran things like this. We also ran through ceilings. It was very common to go through and have basically like electrical resistive wires just running in a ceiling, okay, and then when you would turn them on, they would just basically start resisting and the ceiling would get hot, okay? And we even still use a variation of that today. In some bathrooms, if you go to a very luxurious bathroom these days, like in someone's home, you may walk onto the tile floor in the bathroom and realize, ooh, it's kind of nice. It feels all warm and toasty. And usually what happens is over on the sidewall, you'll see some little thermostat. It's just electro-resistive heating, and it's basically introducing that to the grout or the concrete that's underneath the tile. So, you know, those are perfectly sort of valid systems. Not the most efficient, okay, but they actually sort of worked. So electric resistive heating was sort of a good way of doing things. It was an okay way of doing things. You can't use electric resistive to do cooling, you know, so we needed some other strategy for doing that. Okay, so let's take a look at another system. This guy over here is the idea of having a baseboard hydronic radiator. Let's talk about this. If you're going to have radiators, they're going to have one of two things going through them. They're going to have steam going through them, or they're going to have hot water going through them. Okay. Now, typically the steam or the hot water that comes in is at a fixed temperature. It came from either a boiler down in the basement or a hot water plant over on the other side of campus. It came in at some sort of temperature. So your only way of adjusting the amount of heat you have or don't have is to sort of just control the flow of water through that thing. But there's no real heating or cooling going on there. All it's really doing is based on the amount of water going through and some fins in there that let air go past the radiator, it just heats the room. What tends to happen is air convects. So what happens is, let me go to my little guy over here to draw some drawing. What's going to happen is down at the bottom there'll be some slots that draw cool air into the bottom of this thing. And what's going to happen is out of the top, hot air will rise. And then kind of come into the room. Okay, and that's sort of a very common way of doing it. Now, if you've ever been in a room that has, this is kind of a baseboard, it's kind of a more modern way of doing it. There's, if you've been in older rooms, you probably have these big old radiators that sit over on the wall and they clank a lot as the steam is going through them. And they're actually very hot to the touch. If you happen to brush up against one, you can get burned pretty easily. Okay, those are, again, sort of a very valid way of doing it. We don't use them so much because it's just not as efficient. So if I was putting a new radiant system in a home today, I'd probably use something like this. It's a very clean way of doing it, little baseboard radiators. But we could either do it in the radiator or we could actually do it in the floor. If we're gonna do it this way, let's just kind of take a look at it. You'll sort of see that this thing just really has two connections. It has an in and an out. So basically we're just gonna run water pipes kind of coming to it, the inside and the outside. And if we have a whole bunch of them, we just string the water pipes along and run the system that way. So how that might look, for example, is if I go over to the mechanical plan. I have a little radiator kind of hanging out over here on the wall. The number of radiators you'll need will probably be related to the amount of cooling in the space. We tend to put them under windows. Again, it's for the same reason we put the heating vents there. It just kind of makes sense to do that. So I'll just put another radiator over here, depending on how much heating I need in this room. Okay, and what we tend to do is just run them all together ducted, or we just basically go through and put some pipe in there. If you come onto one of these, you'll see it has an in and an out. This little guy over here is very useful to you. It's kind of like the thing, that our little widget that's on the side of the air handler for creating ducts. If you click on that, okay, it'll basically just start to create a length of pipe for you. Okay, so if I do it on the other side over here, on. Look onto this side. I'll choose that guy. I'll say, let's go ahead and create an out pipe. I'm going to run it right over to this one, which will be the in pipe of that one. I thought I hit it. Let me come back over to the other side over here. And again, I'll run this over. Now, where I'm going to run this to really depends, again, on my control system, in that if I want all of the different rooms to sort of share the same hot water, which is probably the way I'm going to do it, and just control on the individual radiator how much hot water or heat I'm introducing into that room, okay, I probably would do it this way. Just kind of run them all along the sides of the building. Let me switch that over to 3D so we can take a look at that. That's kind of a pretty sloppy representation of it. Let me see if I can get any finer. No. It looks like just the way this thing is modeled, it's actually showing it as though it's all running exactly there. More typically what would actually happen is, and you could spend the time to model it, but I probably wouldn't, is it would happen that it comes out. Actually, it usually happens inside the unit. It goes down into the floor, and then it runs under the floor, and then pops up again on the other side, just so you're not sort of looking at that piece of pipe running in the room. Okay, but that's pretty much it. It just starts with just routing those things together. Now, this kind of radiant system is actually sort of a real common way of doing it. The advantage of doing it this way is it's easy to sort of retrofit in a space. If I already have a floor, I can put these on the baseboards and I can go through and just run the hot water pipes to it and start doing my heating. But it's not necessarily the most efficient way again. And the reason is, okay, we're sort of heating up really good over here on the sidewall, but really getting that heat over to you on the other side of the room, we're really counting on air to go ahead and distribute that heat. Okay, and the air will kind of come up through, it'll convect through there and rise on up, and it'll be nice and toasty over here, but it may not be so warm over on that side of the room, because it really, it's kind of a long way. Okay, so doing it this way is kind of A-okay, but yeah, it's not necessarily the most efficient way of doing it. So the more premium way to think about it, if you have the availability, and not everyone has the availability, but if you're running some brand new structure and you have sort of the ability to get to the slab and you're not gonna have to tear up a lot of hardwood floors and things like that, you can get to it, it might be better to actually just run the pipes just right through the floor or on the floor, cover them with concrete, okay, and let the concrete absorb the heat from the pipes and then radiate it out slowly. So that's kind of considered a very nice system, and by approaching it that way, you tend to get sort of a very nice, even heating and cooling throughout the entire system. Yes, Henry.
So the building with multiple uses and multiple different loads and different spaces. The radiant floor, is it the cooling that's coming into the entire building the same?
A very, very good question. That's actually an excellent question. It's sort of the same thing that happens here at Y2E2. It's the same sort of thing. Let's kind of talk about that, because if we ran the same pipe under the entire building, okay, then you'd say, hey, everyone's basically getting the same heating or cooling, so no one has any individual control. And the answer is no, we do it a little bit different. What we'll tend to do is actually run pipes to one room at a time, bring those pipes back to a central location that we'll call a valve manifold. Okay, and then we just have different little valves there that turn on or off, controlling the amount of flow through the different rooms.
Is this controlled by sensors, thermostat?
Yeah, it's controlled by thermostats in the individual rooms. So let's go to a floor plan and we'll see how that would actually play out. Because I think that's actually a really good, you know, kind of strategy to look at. So if I came back over here, I'm just going to go to my mechanical plan over here on the floor. And even here, oh, what am I going to do? I'm going to just turn this off so that I'm not looking at all this air. Actually, I don't want to see all those ducts. Maybe I'll just do this. I'll say visibility graphics, and I'm just going to turn off the ducts and the duct systems and all that kind of stuff. Because I don't want to see any of those. Maybe I'll also get the air terminals. Maybe mechanical equipment too. Fluxidux. I probably should have done it the other way, which would be to say, let me see if I can turn it off this way. I'm going to go to the view range. Let's say the top of that is just level one at 5 feet or something like that. Okay. There's different ways I'm hiding things that are happening above me on the roof. Okay, so here is the idea. I have my four different spaces. I would like to go through and have some sort of a radiant system going through these spaces. Just conceptually, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go through and run some pipes that are going to go back and forth through the space like this. Probably a little bit straighter than that. At the end, though, I see I have sort of two ends to this whole system. I need to bring them back to a series of valves. So what I will usually have is somewhere in the building, I'll have some little closet, some little mechanical room or something that actually has all the different valves in them. And what I'll do is basically just run that part over here and run that part over here. So that's loop one. Similarly, I could go ahead and have loop two, where loop two will come over and do the same sort of thing over here. And come on back, and that'll be loop two. And we'll basically create a whole series of different loops, and what'll happen is in each of the different rooms, so in this room over here, and in this room over here, will be some sort of thermostat, which is based on the temperature in that room. It's either going to turn on the valve or turn off the valve, depending on what we need. So, yeah, Henry.
I'm not sure how much detail I'm going to this. Do you use the same size pipe?
We tend to actually use the same size pipe. What they'll tend to do is, if we'll assume the pipe is all under about the same pressure or something like that, yeah, we'll just sort of control how much we heat by controlling the length of the pipe. It's not very high pressure.
And it's the same temperature?
Yes.
You don't change the temperature?
You don't change the temperature. It's really just whether it's flowing or not.
Okay.
Okay.
And do you use the same set of pipes for hot and cold?
If you want to go through and heating through the radiant system definitely works. Some people will challenge the whole idea of whether you should cool through a radiant system. Yeah, it's okay, but yeah, it would be the same set of pipes. You're just running a temperature of water through it. Okay, so if you ran cool water through, it would have a cooling effect. If you ran hot water effect, hot water, it'd have a heating effect. Okay, if you actually want to see a system like this at some point, go on down to Coupa. Okay, and go over to the elevator that's over on the, I guess, the north side of the red atrium. But instead of going looking at the elevator on the left side, look to the right side and you'll see a little window kind of cut out in the wall there. You can actually see all the pipes coming up to a series of different valves, and that's actually how this building is controlled. So they ran under all of our floor a radiant system like this. We all have these little thermostats. Okay, they're controlling either the radiant or the air or a little bit of both in terms of what's going on. But it's all feeding into a control system. And then based upon our perceived temperature, it'll go through and change the amount of water running through that system. So it's actually quite okay. The interesting thing about radiant systems overall is, okay, A, they're really efficient, because passing heat or cool through water tends to be a very efficient thing to do. The disadds, if there are disadds, are, well, some work to run that pipe around. You need access to things. If I had a lot of hardwood floors or tile, I wouldn't want to rip it all up. I'd want to do it before I put all that down. Okay. Advantages, they tend to have, if you especially put them in concrete, like a good thermal mass. So even though I heat them up, if I stop heating, it'll continue to stay warm and kind of cool down gradually, or it'll sort of cool, heat up gradually. The disadd, though, is it takes a while to do that. Okay, so if all of us came running into the room and there were 100 of us here and it was really hot, it would take a while to cool things down using this strategy. Okay, so we might be uncomfortable for a little while as this is waiting to catch up with us. And that leads to, I think, what you were alluding to, the notion of a hybrid strategy. Okay, if you take a system like this and you use this to sort of get the baseline of the heating or the cooling to a comfortable level. So, it's warm outside today. Maybe we would like the floor temperature in here to be somewhere around like 67 or 68. We try to get it to some baseline that we think is pretty close to the comfort zone of what we like. Then what we could do is, if we all spill into this room and it starts getting warmer and warmer, we could turn on the heating, or the cooling, excuse me, but we only have to cool it like down to that like 68. That's established like a baseline level. Oh, let me go ahead and put the charger in. Yeah, so the idea is that baseline gets to be a really useful thing, and what you can do is basically either preheat or pre-cool your building to the baseline that you want it to be in the evening, so that it's already sort of at that baseline when people come in the morning. And that's a little bit about what goes on inside this building. So radiant systems, or hybrids of radiant systems, tend to be, if you're really worried about energy efficiency, a very nice way of doing it, but they're a little more costly to install typically. So let's think about how you can model something like that, because it's really not too awfully bad, but it sort of runs with pipes, very much like we were running the pipes around just a moment ago to kind of connect those radiators together. Here's the scoop. So if you go over to a nearby systems tab, in addition to all those ducts that we've been running around with, you'll find pipes. And if you choose the pipes, we can go through and choose a certain type of piping, choose an elevation for the piping, and just the material the pipe's made out of. If I choose pipe, you'll see I have some sort of a piping system going on over here. These are sort of standard pipes. There's different families of pipes. You can think about whether they're going to be copper, or if they're going to be steel, or whatever they're going to be. Right now we only have a single pipe defined by default, and it looks like it's a copper segment. Okay. The reality is, these days for radiant systems, we typically do them in a material called PEX, which is very much like, it's kind of like a plasticky pipe, something like that. For if you're going to run a lot of water and it's not under an incredible pressure, PEX is a good way to do it. But let's just think about its parameters. These pipes, if I was going to guess, are going to be somewhere on the order of about a half inch in diameter. They're not very big. If we needed more flow, we could have a bigger diameter pipe. We have an offset. That's the offset relative to the level. If I'm going to put them on level one and I'm going to put them in the floor of level one, then what I'm going to do is basically give it a negative offset. So if the floor slab is, for example, 6 inches, I might give it an offset of 3 inches. That way it'll be embedded right in. If you, because you have a structural floor, have a lot of reinforcing running around in there, you may not want to run them through the structural floor. What they'll do is they'll let you do the structural floor with all its reinforcing and its cables that are sort of tensioning it, and then we'll go through and they'll just put a thin layer, a topping layer of concrete on top of that. So they'll put the pipes down and then put like a, you know, inch thick of kind of a thermal material that's really, it's not there for its strength, it's just there to absorb the heat and distribute the heat. Okay, so you can get a little bit of a sandwich. But I'll go for the 3 inches below right now. You are going to want to, if you can think about this, create a whole series of different parallel pipes. So what you can do is, I'm going to choose the system type. This is either going to be hydronic supply or return. For our purposes, in a radiant floor system, it's really the same. I'm just going to call it a supply system, because actually it's like a closed loop. It just comes on back. There's sort of a hot end and a cold end, just depending upon the way it's flowing. Okay. Actually, even in there, let me go back and check again. I don't think there's a type in there specifically for radiant. Nope, so I'll just call it hydronic supply. We'll come through and I'll run a nice piece of pipe over here. Oops. Looks like, as a starting point, it's probably going to tell me that I can't see the pipe. That is because the pipe is 3 inches below the level, and I bet my settings are set so that I can't see that. So let me change the view range. I'll say I can let that go down to, minus a foot. Minus a foot in there. Okay, so there I have that first pipe. It's hanging around looking not too bad. Here's the deal. Radiant pipes actually have this very nice attribute that they're typically all parallel to each other. So you can go through and run the radiant pipe, just by running another pipe right over here, and do your best to kind of create a nice pattern with it. Or there's a really nice tool set up to make that a little bit easier for you. And what you can do is choose that first pipe. And when you do that, I'll find it in here somewhere. Where are my modified pipes? Not analysis. There's like parallel pipes. My screen is so squishy, it's hard to see anything. That's pipe insulation. That's a group. I want it to be under modified pipes. Let's see if you guys see it, because I'm just having trouble seeing where it is. Oh, there's parallel pipes. It's right there. Oh, maybe I have to click it first. Parallel pipes. What's it going to want? Select a pipe to create a parallel to. And then it looks like there's probably a setting. Where am I not seeing the setting for my parallel pipes? Oh, there we go. We have the whole choice of how many pipes and what's the offset vertically, all that good stuff. So let me go ahead and do that a little more smartly. I'm going to take out that one. I'm going to go over to my parallel pipe settings and say that I want to. Let's go ahead and, for my purposes, get that out of the way first. Let's go ahead and create, I don't know, like say 20 pipes. They're going to have a horizontal offset of like a foot. That should be fine. I'll choose that pipe, maybe even further. Maybe make them out every 2 feet. Okay, so I got a whole bunch of pipes in there. Now, once you go through and create all these different pipes, we just now need to route them together in some sort of a sense of directionality. So what you can do is, with those same old pipes here, just sort of say, I'm going to connect you to you. Connect you to you. You to you. Okay, on the back end, I'll loop those together. And And now we're ready to run at least that portion of it back to the closet. So if I say that super, I'm going to bring those out. Come on over here and take them to some sort of a utility closet. Do the same thing on this side over here. I'm going to take those across. And I would do the whole room. Okay, so now you have something which is like a radiant system for that floor. And the idea is you do a bunch of these. We do a similar sort of thing for room 2 and room 3 and bring them all back so they're coming back to this manifold. And Jacqueline, you got a really funny look on your face. So what are you thinking about? Just some rabbit goofiness, or what are you thinking?
I'm just thinking that I was to run a showing system using the lights.
Yes.
If it's like right on the floor level, then it serves me, it never goes up yet, because everything is low and cool.
Oh, that is sort of an interesting issue of mixing. Yeah, so let's think about this.
Always in the lower level.
So let's think about how you'd address that. The reason we tend to use radiant pipes in the floor is because often we're trying to heat with them. And then when it's time to cool, we blow air or open a window or something like that. That's because we don't have very hot climates here. So we tend to do it this way. You're right. The effect of the radiance on the floor, if it's warm, it's kind of nice because we're actually kind of down on the floor. So the biggest zone of the radiance is down here where we are. It's not as effective when we get up there, okay? You know, but the heat will rise slowly. If you were going to plan this more as a chilling system, it might be better to run them in the ceiling above and have the cool air drop, okay? So think about doing something like that. So if you want to use sort of a radiant cooling system, they do things like that. Other things they'll do is, again, concrete walls, they'll actually run the radiant pipes just up and down the walls. So the walls are actually cooling surfaces. So that's another way to kind of think about it. Any of the different surfaces, you know, as long as it has thermal mass, could be a heating or cooling surface. And that might be kind of nice because, you know, although it's a little warm or a little cold, it's not so hot or so cold to the touch that it's uncomfortable. It just has that little bit of warmth to it. But the idea is you want to, with radiant systems, there's sort of two effects. There's the radiant effect, which is if you're sort of close to it, you sort of feel the radiant heating or the radiant cooling. You sort of directly feel it because the energy just through the atmosphere, just sort of it radiates and your skin absorbs it, your body absorbs it. But also you're heating or cooling the air. And then if the heating or cooling of the air happens, you need to have the air moving so that it circulates and sort of fills the whole room. So that's why, again, even in the whole hybrid strategy, it's kind of good. If you have a little bit of air moving, then you can get the heat off of the floor and get it to fill back up in the space. Which you typically have because you typically need to ventilate the space even though you're doing the heating and cooling with a radiant system. So you have a little bit of air moving around. Yes?
You said the radiant cooling isn't kind of debatable. But if you do it, you put it in the top floor to cool the bottom?
It would be more effective there in terms of, for the reason Jacqueline cites, to kind of like have it there. Let me tell you why people typically don't do it. And it's sort of a funny thing. It has to do with just, it's the humidity that typically comes with the heat. Okay, so what happens is if you cool hot, wet air, hot, humid air, water comes out of it. So if you are in Eric's class, he'll tell a story about how when he's seen systems like this, it's quite fine until like someone opens a door or a window, at which point the humid air comes in, then all of that humid air hits the cold surface and it starts raining inside just because all the water is dripping on down there. Which is why for a cooling system, often we won't do this. We'll do something that actually has more of a dehumidifier as part of it too, so that as you cool the air, you have a way to capture the water and send it out. Yeah, but it definitely works well for heating. Yeah.
So instead of capture the water, is that significant enough to fill a tank?
You could fill a tank with the water that actually comes off. If you ever have had a dehumidifier in your home, it actually, it actually collects a significant amount of water. You're not watering the lawn with it every day, but you're flushing toilets, but it's enough that it's a significant amount. Yeah. In fact, it's things like this that really create so much trouble. If you run into, there's all these different things about buildings that fail over time, where there's mold in the walls, or there's sort of rot and problems like that. Very often, it's not rain leaking in or something like that. It's just that the humid air is being chilled and the water is coming out of it in the bad spot. Like, you don't want the water to come out inside the walls, because then it sort of gets very wet and moist and humid and moldy inside the walls and starts rotting. So we pay a lot of attention to that. So what we end up having to do is put, if you ever hear us talking about vapor barriers, okay, that's a layer we put in addition to the thermal barrier, just to keep the water from going to a place where it's going to get cold. So it's a really interesting issue about when warm air gets chilled, where does the water drop out of it? Because it will. In these sorts of systems, what's happening is, well, actually, they've had the problem here before where, these need to be drained. Okay, but they've had problems where water's been leaking out of these things before. And it's really just that kind of warm, humid air is being cooled, okay, and at that point, water comes out. Yeah, check
that out. Although I'm not planning to make a system like this, but I'm just curious if I was to run pipes in the ceiling, is it independent with those for the sprinklers?
Yes. Yeah, so think about the heating and cooling water is different from the sanitary water and the domestic water and the sprinkler water. They're all sort of separate systems. And the reason is just, it's different loads and sort of different pressures on each of those different systems. Sprinklers are actually a really funny category of piping because it's really high pressure water. What happens is, at the time, you don't need it for years and years, but at the time you do need it, you need a lot of water in that location really fast. So it's incredibly high pressure. Okay, so they're designed as a separate system as opposed to, this kind of water is relatively low pressure. It's just, you're just trying to move a little bit of heat around kind of slowly but surely and keep it circulating. So at a high level, radiant systems look something like this. Again, either in the floor or in something like this, where we have these little baseboard radiators. There's different ways of doing it. And it really depends on the, kind of what sort of access you have to do the construction. In an older building, what they'll sometimes do, like in your building, do you know if it has concrete floors or wooden floors, or what is that?
I think it would have had wooden floors probably.
Okay, so in a case like that, even sometimes because the wood is sort of clackety, it's like you could, they'll put a thin layer of concrete on top of it, okay, and then they can run like sort of radiant pipes to that or something. Okay. They'll actually do a system like this with the radiant pipes. We'll even do it in the case where we have wooden joists. In a lot of homes, we have wooden floor joists, and it's not the most efficient system, but what they'll do is they'll actually do something like this. We'll have a system where the floor is coming across. There's a whole series of wooden joists that are coming down. So what they'll actually do is they'll take those radiant pipes and they'll run them right here and right here, and they'll staple them to the bottom of the floor. So they'll put little brads in that hold them up. Now, that's an okay strategy. It's not necessarily a great strategy because most of the radiant pipe is just radiating out to this air as opposed to actually radiating up into a good surface with good thermal mass. So that's not nearly as effective. So the other thing they'll do sometimes is they'll put some sort of surface, it's almost like made of aluminum. We'll put a surface on the top that has little ridges in it. I guess I should draw it the other way. But What's going to happen is they'll put the radiant pipes in these little channels. I should draw it the other way. It's actually upside down. They'll have like a little aluminum tray, and there'll be a notch where you stick the pipe in, and a notch, and a notch. And then it's a little bit better. You at least have the radiant pipe heating up a piece of aluminum, which distributes it around a little bit. Okay, so that's a little bit nicer. But no, radiant system, just something to consider in your mix. So it could be radiant this way, it could be radiant radiators. Now, split systems, we haven't talked very much about those. But there's another approach to this. Yeah. Lots of different strategies. A split system actually is sort of amazingly similar to like these. If we find the right unit, we're just going to put it up high on the wall, and then it's going to have basically pipes running to it. Got electricity running to it, and a pipe running to it and away from it that connects the coolant from the split system that's on the wall out to the radiator, which is sitting somewhere else, or to the coil. Let's see if I even have something like that. I'm not sure if I do. Although, let's try this. Go over to a nearby. Let me do it. I'll go to seek. Seek.os.com is a great place for finding a lot of different pieces. Let me go ahead and sign in here. Parts that different manufacturers have made available. Think of it as like Revit City, but it's the officially authorized version that actually has stuff that's been sort of certified. Let's see if I can find any like split system. Yeah. There's a split system. That's the part that's typically sitting out on the outside. You have the little chilling unit or the cooling unit that's kind of hanging out there. What else do I have in here? That's just a big air handling unit.
Air conditioner.
This is actually the same sort of thing, split system air handler. You got an air conditioner? Now check this out, concealed ducted series air conditioner, fantastic. So, that's more of a furnace. Okay, something like this is one that we could actually put up inside of a ceiling plane, which is very nice if you don't want them hanging around on the wall. That looks like it's concealed also. I'm trying to find one of those groovy ones that just sort of hangs out on the wall. This is, again, kind of a concealed one. This is going to hang out up in the ceiling and basically just have pipes running to it. That's a suspended one, okay, which is probably not as good. That would be hanging under the ceiling. A floor standing exposed air conditioner. Wall mounted. Let's take a look at that. That, I think, is probably closer to what we have in mind. So if we go through and let me just download the Revit family. Okay, let's download that. We'll go out there and take a look at it. Do a little insert. Go out to my downloads. What do I got here? Oh. Mitsubishi air conditioning system. Let's see what I can find, where I can find this. I think of it as being a piece of mechanical equipment, but we'll see. Looks like it's trying to load it in, but we'll see. I'm not sure what it's trying to do right now. Oh, there we go. I just put one on my wall there. So let's go back and take a look at this. Okay, and that's kind of the typical unit, although it's facing, I think, the wrong side of the wall here, or it's facing to the outside right now. What's happening here is there's heating and cooling happening within here. What's happening is air just gets sucked in from the bottom and kind of blows across the top. Or does it work the other way in the cooling sense? The other way in the cooling sense. Okay, so it's sucking in the warm air from the top. The warm air has risen to the ceiling and then blows it down. That's why I hate these things, because if your head looked like mine, you don't like cold air blowing at you.
That's why it's usually by the corners.
I'll say that again?
That's why it's usually by the corners, so you don't get the airflow.
Ah, okay. Very good. So it looks like it has some sort of a connection in here. This is basically going to some sort of hydronic piping system. Okay, and then over here on this side, it looks like it has a little bit of an electrical. Okay, so super, a lot of ways to go through and do this. You just gotta think about a strategy for, you know, the big considerations are you doing it centrally, or are you doing it locally, or somewhere between? Here on campus, we do our heating and cooling in this giant plant on the side of campus, okay, where it's done incredibly efficiently for the entire campus. And then hot and cold water lines go running from the plant to our building, okay, and then supply all these little units where we do things on the end. We have some air handlers on our roof that are all about just blowing the air down that works with the hot or cold water to do it, okay. But it's all about thinking about, you know, where is the equipment going to be and what strategy you want to use for the heating or cooling or combination of strategies. Yeah, Henry.
Does that take in air from outside?
This actually doesn't. These kind of units just only work with air internal to the room and blow it through. Okay, so what would they? They are good from the standpoint of, like, you know, they're moving the air, but they're not introducing fresh air.
I'll say some of them are, because they penetrate through the wall.
Ah.
So they have another unit outside.
Yes.
That you drain outside and you pull in air.
Very good. Oh, so you could pull in the fresh air too and distribute it that too also. That's very good. Because I usually think of these only as having a chiller, a heater or a chiller, usually a chiller, out on the ledge somewhere, but not actually pulling air. So they actually have some that actually bring air in too.
Yeah, that's why if you're outside those air conditioners, they will blow hot air into you.
Yes.
Because that's what they do, yeah.
Yeah, hot air has to go somewhere. There's a very funny thing.
It's very funny that it's super hot outside. And
yes.
Even
no, I'm just, that's funny. It's less than, I'm sure. There's this funny thing people do, all the thermodynamics behind heating and cooling are funny, where, you know, on a hot day, people will go ahead, they have these funny little air conditioning units you could put inside your house, which is really kind of funny because that heat has to go somewhere. You know, you need to have something where all the hot air is going outside. Otherwise, it's just kind of a trap system. So, yeah, all the thermodynamics are kind of funny about how, like, the heating or cooling has to go somewhere. A very efficient way, though, that we haven't really talked about very much is heat pumps, especially ground source heat pumps. There, we actually circulate that same sort of water as opposed to taking it over to our central heating or cooling plant. We run it under the ground, and we use the underground temperature, which is usually a pretty constant, you know, 60 degrees-ish sort of temperature. We use that to go through and either heat or cool air or water, or in this case, the fluid, you know, the cooling fluid, to a pretty good temperature so that we can, like, use that as a sort of a preheating thing. But even we can take air and run it through. Heat pumps are this very efficient way of doing things where they can extract hot or cold depending on the change in the outside temperature. Yeah, No, you can think of, so in some cases, the ground is acting as a heat sink, and in cold weather cases, it's acting as a heat source. But either way, it's like almost no amount of heat you can put in that's going to make a significant change to the Earth, so it's pretty constant. Okay, let's just kind of pause there on the heating and cooling, because I think really, until you start digging in and just sort of thinking about your own strategy, you know, everyone's model will be a little bit different based on what they're thinking about doing. Actually, Brad, I don't think I asked you, what are you thinking about for your space? The difference will be, so let's think about that trade-off, because there is, if you're heating primarily through the radiant, what'll tend to happen is the ducts can be a little bit smaller. Okay, just because then, although if they're cooling, yada, 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 it sort of depends. Yeah, it depends. Yeah, so, it could go either way. You think about one of these split systems, there's a lot of things we could do, or these like a ceiling-based systems or something like that. There's like a lot of efficient ways to do it. Yeah, and you know, in general, whenever we're moving water, it's just more efficient than moving air. Okay, let us pause there. Yes, Henry, what you got?
Oh, sorry. Does that mean inducting?
In this case, this unit that I think we're looking at here, let's just even take a look at it. I don't think it has a duct opening, but it might. Every unit's a little bit different. I can see that it definitely has some sort of bidirectional. What's going on? That's the electrical connection. I can tell that. Let's see what this part is over here. That's a water connection. I think it is a water connection. So my impression of this one is that specific unit doesn't have a ducting requirement. However, there's going to be other ones that do.
Okay,
it depends on whether they're just sort of like generating or kind of producing and relieving their heat here, or whether I don't know what's going on there. Yes, I think that only has the one. Just a hydronic supply. Okay. Let us stop and pause, though, and think about this whole issue of how big these things have to be and how do you estimate how big these things have to be. Because every room and ultimately the building has a certain amount of heating you have to provide and cooling you have to provide. And it's based on, the number of people, the outside air temperature, the thermal properties of your room, all those different things add up together to ultimately say, if I want to keep this room within a comfortable zone and be temperate, to be cooled down when it gets too hot, to be warmed up when it gets too cold, I need to go through and provide some heating or cooling. Okay, so ultimately, those things are sized just based on all those different sort of thermal properties. So it gets back to your building envelope. So even to kind of take a look at that, let's go back and, if you can, open up a different file. I'm going to open up, it's under session 15, actually it's under session 16, because I made some changes and moved it. It's called HVAC test cases. And really, the one that's most interesting to me is the one that says import model with spaces defined. I was doing a little playing around before we got in here with the whole notion of, did it make a difference whether you had thermal properties defined in the architectural model and linked them into the mechanical model and did the analysis in the mechanical, or if you need to actually do the analysis back in the in the architectural. And it turns out it gives the same answers, which is good. We actually sort of like that. But let's go ahead and, I'll open the one with spaces defined. Because this is, again, the same little model. Let me go ahead and open it in 3D. can. What we've done is we've linked this into a mechanical model, but even though it's a linked item over here, the spaces are defined over here, and we're doing all the kind of using of the thermal properties over here. So it's a linked model, that's okay, but if you actually tab and choose one of them surfaces, like this roof surface, you'll see it actually has some thermal properties. There it is. It has an R58 roof to it right now. Or if I go to these walls, I can say that these are some sort of R54 walls, so very good walls. Even the floor right now, I think, has some nice thermal properties to it. If I take a look at that concrete floor and I edit it, it looks like it has an R value of 13 right now. It's one of those things I always used to forget about. I think we ran into that a lot during fall quarter, was the whole idea that it really does pay to insulate your floor, because if you have a super insulated building, it'll always go to the weakest link. And if the floor is the weakest link, you'll have heat leaking out through the floor. Okay, so I have some thermal properties here. And then we even went through and define some spaces. So if you define some spaces, okay, we have all these different spaces, and for the spaces, I have different uses associated with them. Now, spaces again, this is all gonna ultimately affect the calculations for how much heating and cooling you need. They have a space type, so whether it's the overall space type or whether you're gonna have a different space type in a particular room, it has the whole question of the people, the construction technique, whether it's occupied or not, all these different sort of things factor into sort of the calculation. So at a high level, is it heated and cooled or not? Okay, with the construction type, they're all sort of in here, but let's go to actually the definitive source in terms of what some of these settings do, and that's actually to go back over to the Revit help system, which we often forget to go back and look at, but if you ever have a question of really how all the different parameters are actually affecting the model, it's good to go on back here. So level, we sort of understand a lot of that. Electrical lighting, electrical loads, mechanical airflow. This is the whole issue of really as it goes through and calculates how much air needs to come through for ventilation or heating or cooling. When I get on down to energy analysis, we have the conditioning type, heated, cooled, heated and cooled, unconditioned. And it'll tell you a little about here. So basically, when it's set to unconditioned, no loads are calculated for that space. Heated, only the heating loads will be calculated. Cooled, only the cooling loads will be calculated. So if you have open air spaces, make them unconditioned. If you have a space where you're going to heat, but you aren't going to cool, or cool, but not going to heat, kind of change it over to either be cooled or heated or unconditioned. Heated and cooled would be both. Okay. It's a little ambiguous about vented and natural ventilated. I'm going to have to go back in there. In general, my understanding of this is that vented is not going to heat or cool. It's just going to push air relative to kind of keeping the ventilation right. And natural vented, I think then, it's not even going to push air. It's just going to go through and count on natural ventilation. Okay, but we should go back and look in more detail. In terms of how these play out over here, different things sort of heated and cooled. If I say that, it's going to compute both the loads. Space type, there's a building space type. The building space type is coming from your analysis settings. So if you come over here and you say that under your energy analysis, that it is a school or university, it's going to use that as the primary space type. But as you learned in A, if you go through and choose an individual space, you can go through and diff that if you want. So if I want to change that, I can choose one of those and kind of change to another space type to give a more accurate distribution. I think Sanche, when you did it, we saw it. I think Henry, when you did it too, we saw it, that like changing the space types had a very big difference on the number of people. And then based on that, the loads change pretty significantly. So the more accurate you can make this, the more accurate your projection is going to be. So it may make the raw problem better, it may make the problem worse, but it's more accurate. So it's definitely worth trying to change some of these. For example, on this model right now, I took that space type there and I called it a corridor. So there's just fewer people in there. There's less of a heating load because of that. Or there's less heat being generated by those people. On the building, let's talk about that. Because for the building, there's always this issue of kind of what the constructions are. And this is the one that I think is so confusing. By default for the building, all these overrides are turned on. So if all these overrides are turned on, then the thermal properties that you put in are being ignored because they're being overridden by these thermal properties. So what I usually do is go ahead and turn all these off so that I'm going to use the thermal properties that I put in and took the time to kind of customize and rev it. But watch out for that. We'll actually kind of take a look at the effect of that just by looking at how it actually plays out. So if they're turned off, you get one set of values. If they're turned on, you get a different set of values. Because these values here may not be as aggressive as some of the ones that you put in. So if you put in better values, then you want to use those instead. The advantage of doing this is if you really quickly want to see the effect of changing all the floors or all the walls, you can change it in one place. And it just has, a really quick kind of calculation for you. To see the effect of those different things, let me go ahead and I'm going to open up some analysis results that I ran just before you guys all came in. Okay, here's the same building, but I looked at it three different ways. I looked at it in terms of if I analyze it and use rooms instead of spaces, if I use the spaces and I left the building overrides turned on, okay, and if I turn them back off. Okay, and here's what you sort of find. The floor area is about the space. Same, you'll notice that in the room scenario, there's 94 people in the building. In the spaces scenario, there's 81 people in the building. Okay, so a little difference there. Okay, if we go down and look at the EUI, under the room scenario, where I did tell it to use the thermal properties, it's a 65 kilobtu. If I go ahead and instead have it using the building overrides, it's 187, so they got a factor of 3. And it really is just based on whether you have that checkbox turned on or turned off. So watch out for it. That checkbox is very significant, or that series of checkboxes. If I instead look at the same building and I use spaces, but I leave the overrides turned off, I turn those off actively, I get the 81 people, okay, and I have the EUI here. Now, the whole notion of the EUI here and why it's higher here than in rooms, it's using the same thermal properties as fewer people, but there's something else going on in terms of whether it's the lighting power or something other in terms of the floor area is the same, the temperatures are the same. There's some other factor that's sort of like popping through that's actually going on, making the change why the EUI is actually a little bit higher here. But it's more accurate to what's going on. I haven't been able to spot what it is right offhand in terms of the spaces. It's 0.09, it's 1.09. It's because in the room scenario, we're using a lighting power of 0.99. In the space scenario, we're using a lighting power of an average of 1.09. So, if we want to adjust that, we should go back into the spaces and kind of tweak it down so that it sort of matches the same assumptions. But it makes a huge difference in terms of how you adjust the thermal properties. So this will overall go through and compute for you, these high level numbers in terms of the total heating load, the total cooling load. You can already see here, one of the big differences is in terms of over here, the bounds underground in the room scenario where we have our using our insulation values, underground surroundings isn't so high. If I come over here to the one where I am using the default building values, the overrides, you see that's a huge number. And I think that's really one of the big differences is happening. But it's all just sort of relative scale. I guess the message is be sure that you're using your own thermal properties as opposed to the building overrides. Because as you go into spaces, which I think is generally a better thing to do, it has a small effect. Or a big effect. Yes, Mr. Henry.
So what is underground soundings?
Oh, that's basically, it's the surface that's going to the, like, the ground surface. So in our case, it's really where the bottom of the building touches the ground. So we're losing heat through that surface. Yeah, so in this case, what's happening is if it was uninsulated on the bottom, basically if the ground is cooler and the room is staying warm, heat's gonna radiate down through the floor slab. And how we addressed that in our building was we went through and just put insulation in the floor slab so that it would cut down the amount of heat. You still see that it's still, you know, measurable. It's still more than the windows. So right now, if you were, for example, gonna go ahead and consider whether I should put more money into reducing the window conductivity or more money into sort of putting insulation into the slab, you'd say that it'd probably be more beneficial to put it in the slab. It's all just sort of this trade-off between things. What's happening over here on the cooling side? What's happening there? You see the biggest load there, which is not surprising, on the cooling side, actually is the occupants. It's us and all the heat that we're generating and our computers and everything else, miscellaneous equipment, lighting fixtures. If I lower the lighting power density, you'd expect that to go down. But the window solar, like window conductive, is really next to nothing. And window solar, again, is not really all that great. So we could add some shading to cut down on that. But it doesn't look like it's probably the most productive or the most productive to do, the thing to do at this point. Okay. Let's at a high level kind of look at another tool though that'll help you understand the impact of doing different things. All that data is coming out of ultimately it's the DOE 2.2. It all goes to like either eQuest or I think us all going through eQuest. Well, it's all the DOE 2.2 through Rebuilding Studio. There's a really interesting tool that got added recently called InSight. InSight does this. InSight says all that data that we've put in there, can we go through and basically give us some high-level feedback about how things are going to play out, which things would make the biggest difference. So in order to use it, what you do is you say generate InSight. Generate InSight does an energy analysis using the current settings. And after you've generated InSight, you can run the little InSight report. If you say generate InSight, I'm gonna just say use the report right now, but if you want to, say generate InSight, you'll have to log in and you can run it. What it gives you back is something that looks like this. Well, hopefully more interesting than that. Let's see what I got. Server connection not ready. Well, that's better now. Okay. This little view up here is actually, this is the energy model view. You might want to sort of just check that out. It sort of shows you sort of shading surfaces. It shows you sort of surfaces that are considered wall surfaces and roof surfaces. If you sometimes wonder whether things are being considered in the model, for example, if you wonder whether your mullions are being considered or not, this view is actually kind of a reasonable way to do that. So actually, Henry, I think we tried that one day. You know, we're trying to find the VRML model. So in this tool, that is actually the model. So if in this case, you can see the orange overhang of the roof is being considered. If there were some mullions or some fins, you'd expect to see them there too, as shading surfaces. Okay, so we sort of see the walls and all that type of stuff. But here's what's happening. Based upon the current assumptions for this building, it looks like we are thinking that somewhere around here, this is going to use about $4.31 to actually be possibly an energy generator. Okay, somewhere in there is really where it's going to be. Okay. And given the current assumptions, okay, it currently is targeting 1.01, so around $1.01, which is better than the ASHRAE requirements, but actually not quite as good as the Architecture 2030 requirements. Or we're going to try and reduce all our energy consumption by like 90% or something like that. It's quite a high threshold. So our building right now is actually in pretty good stead. It's a small building, it has very good insulation values. There's a lot of things about it that are sort of making it a pretty good performer. But let's go ahead and just do some analysis to sort of see where the biggest impacts could be. So in terms of these calculations, there's all sorts of little tiles underneath here which allow us to tweak and play with different values. So there's some tiles up here at the top of the screen. Let's see if I can pull that over. Which get into just photovoltaics and the efficiency of that system. So if, for example, you were interested in kind of thinking about photovoltaics, and we had the choice of going anywhere from 0 to 90% covered by photovoltaics on the roof, okay, you see we have a pretty high range of values. Let me see if I can get that out of the way and zoom on down and see this for you. Oops. Come back in here. That's the payback limit, or the service coverage. Okay, you'll see that anywhere from if we have 0% covered all the way up to saying 90% covered, we can actually lower the cost quite a bit. So if you want to go through and kind of really limit the analysis so that it's showing the better values, hang on here. My window is so small, it's hard to do what I want to do. Oh, come on, you. What's going on is the little thing that I want to actually change is below. Yeah, and my window on this like projected screen is so small that I can't get to the part where I actually want to change it. Oh, come on, you. Let's see if we can get this to work. Let me see if I can change my little guy here. Did that do okay? Let's try the inside again. Okay, so in terms of different assumptions here, for example, the amount of photovoltaic coverage, I can basically go through and adjust the amount. And if I go through and say that I want to have 60% coverage or 75%, it'll actually lower the values for me. So I can go through and really say if I'm gonna go through with a very good photovoltaic strategy, sort of see that I can lower the total energy use cost pretty significantly just by going through and supplementing it with photovoltaic panels. Now, photovoltaic panels may not be the only strategy you wanna consider. For example, if you were wondering about the effect of, either different types of the construction. For example, let me go to the roof construction. Right now I have a pretty good value for a roof right now, but if I go to that one, you can sort of see that really the difference between going uninsulated to R10 all the way up to R60 is really pretty negligible. So the idea of this is that it doesn't do a lot of good to go up to R60 because you're just really not going to get a payout back for that. That's not really the issue that's concerning you the most. So I can change that to limit it, but it's going to actually have a very small effect. I could say, what would happen if I wanted to reorient the building? And again, you see there's really not that big a difference. There's a small difference. It looks like it actually gets worse depending if I kind of rotate the building around the other way. You can say, but what about the window to wall ratio? You know, what is the effect of that? And you see there is, again, a small difference. So anywhere from at the high level, if I have a very high window to wall ratio, like 95%, all the way down to 15 or 0%, you'll see I can lower the total energy use intensity. So the idea of this is really just to help you figure out what are the things that make the biggest difference. So one of these things is lighting efficiency. We sort of know that was an issue. So you can see, look at this one. So everything from a lighting efficiency of 1.9 watts per square foot down to 0.3, if I actually just cut the lighting efficiency or improve the lighting efficiency, you know, I could actually bring that down very significantly. Just by putting in higher efficiency luminaires and a lot of LEDs, I could actually have a very huge impact on the energy use, probably more so even than continuing to improve the thermal properties. So that's the idea behind this tool, is just giving you some feedback and some insight. That's why it's called insight, about really where it makes the most sense to go. You're going to notice that what happens is, based upon these assumptions you've made, and the range keeps on adjusting. So we still have the worst to the best case, but you can sort of see we're giving your current set of assumptions, kind of what it thinks the number is going to be, and sort of see how you're doing relative to your overall targets. So it's quite okay. Even what happens in here, you sort of see, actually I'll switch back out to the other screen resolution just so you can see this a little bit better.